If you are visiting with us this morning, there's a green card in the seat back in front of you. If you could just fill that out and place it in the offering plate when it comes by, we'd appreciate if you could do that so we could just connect with you throughout this week. In addition, this Thursday, August 25th, there's the blood drive here at the church. We are short on donors, so if you are able to and you haven't yet, please sign up. It's from 1 to 6. Also, if you know of someone that maybe is not part of our congregation that could donate as well, just reach out to them and ask them. The sign-up sheet is located on the bulletin board. In addition, tonight we are having a church-wide prayer meeting. The focus of this prayer meeting is going to be to pray over our students, the student ministries that we have here at the church, the local, if you will, schools and leaders of our school districts, just to focus on that tonight as we begin our new school year. And then next Sunday, the 28th, we'll actually start up with our programs. So if you're a part of Olympians or Gopher Buddies, you can pick up your materials today after church in the foyer. Youth, they'll come in Tuesday, so you can come by church, or you can just wait till Sunday night, and we'll hand it out to you then. All right? With that being said, let's continue today's service in a moment of prayer. Father, we are thankful. Father, we are a thankful congregation today that we are able to come into your house and to worship you. Father, we are coming today acknowledging who you are, that you are sovereign, that you are over all. Father, that you are loving, and that you are just. And Father, that you are good. And as we continue today in service, I pray that that you would fill our hearts and our minds, that they would be saturated on your truth. Father, that there would be nothing that distracts us from you and your holiness. And then, Father, as we take this time and we think of those that we worship with, we think of those who are unable to worship with us today. And Father, we pray that you would be with them and be near to them and allow them to feel your presence, but also allow them to know how much we love and we care for them and that we are praying for them. And so, Father, in these next few moments that we're together, we pray that your name would be made much of, that you would be lifted high, and that, Father, in light of our lives, that would be said as well, not just limited to a few hours on Sunday morning. Father, we love you. We're thankful for the work that was done on the cross of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray all these things in Jesus' name.
See? As we continue in worship this morning, we're going to turn our attention to prayer. And as we take this time to pray, just bring a few items, needs to your attention. Continue to pray for Joan Kincaid. She had surgery this week and continues to recover. So pray for Joan during this recovery period. Also for Kessler Colson. Kessler will have some tests done this week about some health issues that have been she's been dealing with for some time, but they finally identified what it is. So pray for Kessler and the Colson family as they wait for those results and as the doctors make decisions on what the best way to move forward is. I'd also encourage you to pray for some of our missionaries overseas, Larry Hall and his wife. His wife is expecting a baby here in the next few months, and they serve in Central Asia, which right now there's quite a lot of action going on in Central Asia and all the countries over there. So pray for Larry and his family. This will be their third child. They've had all three while they've been there in Central Asia, and they love it there. He said they have to find out what's going on by watching the American news because they really don't recognize it locally. But they work with Steve and Kathy Sarrett. The Sarrett's were with us a few years ago. So if you'd pray for Larry Hall and his family, especially his wife, as she awaits their next child, I know they'd appreciate that extremely. But as we continue in worship this morning, let's pray together. Father, we sometimes lack the words to honor you fully. When we're reminded of your love, we're reminded of your grace. Father, we're reminded of the many gifts that you've given us in your Son, Jesus. A love that we can never question. Is sure forever and always. Lord, as we gather this morning, I pray that those things have not become boring to us. That reminders of who you are and what you've done, reminders of who we are and what you've done in us through Christ, would not seem rote or normal. The chance to pray to you would not seem insignificant. But Father, we would be put in a place of awe yet again because of all that you've done. And Lord, I pray for those who gather with us this morning who struggle with that sense of awe, either the circumstances of their days or, Father, an overriding sense of guilt or lingering sin, steal their joy of your presence. Do a work in them this morning. Free them that they might worship you fully. But Father, I also pray for those who gather here this morning who that is a very alien idea to them because they don't know you. They're not your children. Father, that as we gather, you would open their eyes, that you would soften their hearts, that all those burdens that want to distract them will be pushed away and they would see and hear clearly the good news of a God who lived the life that we should have lived and died the death that we should have died as a substitute in our place, who loved us. Father, guide us. Be with those that we've mentioned this morning. Be with others that are lingering on our hearts. But Father, help us to believe with confidence that you'll do far beyond our understanding. Father, especially this morning as we turn to your word, do a work that's totally of your hand. Give us eyes to see and hearts to believe, ears to hear what you have to say to your church. Father, we pray this in confidence because of the name of Jesus Christ. It's in this name we pray. Amen. Let's turn together in our Bibles to Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8. If you're using our pew Bibles, you'll find that in page 1005. And this morning, let's begin reading Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 1. Now, the point in what we're saying is this. We have such a high priest, one who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven, a minister in the holy places and the true tent that the Lord set up, not man. For every high priest is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices. Thus, it's necessary for this priest also to have something to offer. Now, if he were on earth, he would not be a priest at all, since there are priests who offer gifts according to the law. They serve a copy and shadow of the heavenly things. For when Moses was about to erect the tent, he was instructed by God, saying, "See that you make everything according to the pattern that was shown you on the mountain." But as it is, Christ has obtained a ministry that is as much more excellent than the old, as the covenant he mediates is better, since it's enacted on better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion to look for a second. For he finds fault with them when he says, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will establish a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah. Not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. For they did not continue in my covenant, and so I showed no concern for them, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws into their minds and will write them on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall not teach each one his neighbor and each one his brother, saying, 'Know the Lord,' for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. For I will be merciful toward their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more." In speaking of a new covenant, he makes the first one obsolete. And what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. And God bless the reading of his word this morning. For those just joining us, we've been in this letter to the Hebrews for about a year, not consistently, but kind of on and off, because you can only handle so much of this book at a time. You kind of get tired. It's very forceful. And as we bring our attention back to the book, it's helpful to summarize what the writer to the Hebrews is dealing with. That the issue at the core of this congregation can be summed up with one very knowable word to many of us. That's the concept of guilt. The Hebrews were dealing with guilt, the same guilt that we deal with, the same guilt that we struggle with. They were dealing with a sense of, how do I deal with this guilt? Because they had heard the message of Jesus Christ. And in hearing the message of Jesus Christ, they responded to it. But in living in the power of this gospel, in living in the power of what God has done in Christ, they still have this overwhelming feeling of guilt, that they lack the confidence to pursue God. They lack the confidence to say for certain, "Jesus loves me, this I know." And in lacking the confidence to pursue God, they also lacked the assurance before him. They wondered. The Bible says that God loves me. The Bible says that God has accepted me. But is it really that simple? Is this really true? So in an effort to bolster their confidence, in an effort to show themselves in a very physical way, they had gone back to using the ceremonial law, the Mosaic law, what the writer of Hebrews is going to refer to as the Old Covenant. Because in offering these sacrifices and following these rules and doing all these requirements, they were trying to deal with their guilt. They were trying to find a way to manage the feelings that every human being has to deal with. Guilt is a common human issue. And all of us in some way have to respond to the guilt of our inadequacy, the guilt of our failures, the guilt of what the Bible calls our sin. And we become experts in having to manage that guilt because we understand if I don't deal with my guilt, I'm left simply with a life of total despair. Feeling useless and powerless, purposeless in so many of these ways. And so if you look around in our society, if you look throughout the ages, you will discover that there's two essential ways that people deal with guilt. Many people deal with guilt by covering it. That was the approach of the Hebrews. That was the approach of so many religious people throughout the ages, that we cover our guilt by throwing ourselves into religious activity. I go to services. I carry out ceremonies. I may serve in some way, shape, or form in an effort to make myself feel better, to make myself think that I matter because I'm doing these things. If religious activity doesn't work, others may try to cover their guilt by ranking themselves against other people. I may not be as good as I need to be, but hey, I'm better than her. Or I'm better than him. If we take more of a defeatist approach to life, we can flip it. That I know I'm pursuing God with everything, but you know what? I'm not quite living as well as him or her. All we're doing in that situation is managing our guilt by trying to rank ourselves either higher or lower than others. And this leads to what is the most soul-drying attempt to cover our guilt, which is religious isolation. Where we think that because of our failures, or we think because of our great religious ability, we can't connect with anyone. Well, I'll never fit in with them. I'll never connect with them. And at its core, it can be the product of us not being willing to legitimately deal with our guilt. We've isolated ourselves out of a sense of protection. Unfortunately, many of our church cultures fuel this type of religious covering of guilt. We must allow people to hide. We allow people to separate. And we don't encourage them to do what the Bible calls us to do time and time again, which is deal with our guilt, not cover it. But there's a second way that most of us have probably experienced in dealing with our guilt, that some cover it and others ignore it. And you may be here this morning ignoring your guilt. That in the process of trying to deal with this overwhelming sense of inadequacy, you tell yourself that it's normal to fall short in these ways. It's normal to sin. And in some cases, this ignoring of guilt approaches the concept of sin either by calling it outmoded. Well, people just don't talk that way anymore. People don't think that way anymore. So I shouldn't really feel bad about this. But as that develops, considering the sin that produces our guilt outmoded leads to considering the sin that produces our guilt offensive. How dare you tell me I should feel bad for this? It's all in an effort to deal with our guilt, to ignore our guilt. I remember a conversation that I had a number of years ago with a couple guys here locally. We were talking, we got to this very issue, and one of the young men said, "Well, you know what, I may be bad, but I'm not Hitler." Yeah, and that's what came to my head. But thankfully, his friend chimed in ahead of time and said, "Hey, buddy, you're not setting the bar very high for yourself." All he was doing was try to ignore his guilt, to ignore the issue, to try to figure out a way to manage the feelings that he dealt with every moment, every time he went to sleep, every time he was forced to consider who he was and what defined him. In a very basic way, that's the issue at the core of the book of Hebrews. What do you do when you feel that guilt? And as we come to chapter 8, what the author is going to provide to us is an introduction of the new covenant. A covenant that was necessary so that God could provide a means that was strong enough to a weak people trying to deal with guilt. If you show up at one of our local schools tomorrow morning and you watch the children walking in or the students walking in, and you notice one of those kids has a backpack that's about one-third backpack and two-thirds duct tape that it broke a year or two ago, and in an effort to strengthen it, they've built this duct tape support system. That backpack will work in some sense of the term, but it's not quite as strong as a new backpack. They really want to be able to handle the burden and the pressure of all of that stuff. They have to be provided a new backpack. That's what the writer of Hebrews is trying to explain to us here. That the old covenant, the Mosaic covenant, provided a means for God to come to his people, to call them to himself. But this covenant needed more strength. It needed something to be able to deal with the guilt that all of us struggle with. We didn't need more instruction in the old ways. We needed a new way to serve and worship God. And what we've been given is a new priest, as the writer has shown us in the first six verses. And now here, beginning in verse 7, a new covenant. A new covenant that could deal with the sin and the guilt that overrides us each and every day of our lives. The struggle to understanding this new covenant first comes in a typical desire, if you've been in church for any length of time, in out with the old, in with the new mentality. That in understanding the book of Hebrews and in understanding the Old Testament and the Old Covenant, we can read it at a very shallow way that gives us a low view, almost a disrespectful view of the Old Testament, the Old Covenant. That we almost want to push it aside and not spend any time there and not understand God's gracious work among his people in the Old Testament, that we just pander it. We set it as something insignificant and not applicable to where we are today. And so one of the first steps we have to make is to actually understand this old covenant, to understand the Mosaic covenant that the writer of Hebrews tells us in both verse 7 and verse 13 was faultless, that there was a need for a second, that it was obsolete. It was becoming obsolete. It was growing old. And as he concludes verse 13, it was ready to vanish away. Not positive ways to describe something that God wrote. And so we have to understand, to have a firm grasp of what the book of Hebrews is talking about here. And so first, we have to know that the covenant the writer is referencing, it's not all the promises of the Old Testament. As you read your Bible, as you read through your Old Testament, you see a number of promises, a number of covenants within those promises. Adam receives a covenant in the early parts of the book of Genesis. Noah is given a covenant by God that we're reminded of every time a rainbow stretches across the sky. The great father Abraham is given a covenant. Moses instills a covenant. And David, the great king, is given a covenant for the promises of God. What we don't have here is God taking aim at any of those other covenants. It's not dealing with the Abrahamic covenant, that through Abraham, God would bless all the peoples of the earth. It was the focus of God's promise to Abraham. And that's wrapped up and fulfilled in the person and work of Christ. So God is by no means setting that covenant aside. The covenant he is focusing on are all those Mosaic rules. As you read through your Old Testament, most people reading their Bible through in the year breeze through Genesis. We breeze through the first part of Exodus. And then you get to the end of Exodus and you start getting the laws and the rules and the ceremonies. And then you hit Leviticus, right? And you start reading at night to cure your insomnia. Because We get bogged down in that stuff. You find these in portions of Numbers and a good portion of Deuteronomy. They're all the ceremonies. They're the requirements. They're the things. If you want to deal with your sin, if you want to remove your guilt, if you want God to accept you, do these things. That is the covenant that the book of Hebrews wants us to have in mind as we deal with the change. All those ways that the people of God in a former age thought that they could find acceptance before God, thought that they could deal with their guilt. And once we understand that's where the writer of Hebrews is focused, we have to be reminded of the purpose of that covenant. Like the writer of Hebrews identifies there in verses 7 and 13, that the old covenant, even as it was in practice, was fading away. It didn't have the strength to provide what God required of its people. It had become obsolete. It was becoming obsolete. It was something fading away. And so if God was going to prepare his people for eternity, the old covenant was not the means to do that. And it was never designed that way. That's why he had to provide this new covenant that is provided for us here in verses 8 through 12, quoting from the great prophet Jeremiah. The old couldn't work anymore. You want a visible way to understand this. If you still have a landline telephone, which is becoming a thing of the past, go home, unplug your wireless telephone. Find a hand crank phone and plug it in, if you can even do it. And then try to make a call. Not going to work, right? Because after you crank it and you call for the operator, you're not going to hear anything on the other line. I don't think we even have operators anymore. It's obsolete. It didn't happen that way all of a sudden, but over a period of time, we were introduced with the technology that was more effective. The purpose of that phone was good, but its usage has passed away. And that's what God has provided in the new covenant, that he has moved to a more effective means with the same purpose. Because if you read through the Mosaic Covenant, if you read through the Old Testament, what you will discover is that the focus was to direct people towards Christ, towards a greater sacrifice. And so the failure was not in the covenant itself. The failure was in the participants. He identifies that in the first part of verse 8, that he, God, finds fault with them, his people, when he says, and then he goes on to quote this new covenant, that the issue was not God's promises. The issue was not God's design. The issue was in the people. His goal was good. God's goal was good, but the people failed. They failed to understand the old covenant's purpose. It was purposed to point them to Christ. That in walking through these ceremonies and reinforcing their inability and the inability of animal sacrifice to deal with ultimate sin, to deal with ultimate guilt, they were to have this lingering, this growing desire for someone greater, for a greater sacrifice, for a greater priest, for one who could deal with this once and for all. And so the old covenant was more an arrow pointing them to a Savior. And the failure came not in God's provisions. The failure came in them being able to see this. That the ceremonies weren't the end in and of themselves. They were to remind us, the blood of sheep and goats cannot wipe away our guilt and our sin. So what the old covenant became and what we excel with, even in our own day, is a guilt management system. If I do this, it will make me who I want to be. The Olympics are a wonderful backdrop for this. Imagine one of these reporters going up to Olympian after their medal ceremony and asking them, so how do you feel now that you've won a gold medal? And the only thing that comes out of their mouth is, well, now I matter. Now I matter in this world because I have this medal. We should feel very sad for that person. Because it may last for a week, it may last for 6 months, it may even last for 4 years, but they're not going to be able to wear that medal around when they're 90. People aren't going to care. I was reading an article a couple weeks ago about college football coaches who have this great notoriety, especially here in southern cities, that they can't go to eat lunch or eat breakfast without being swarmed by all these fans and all this pressure. They talked about how nice it would be to go somewhere and just not be recognized. Well, the article closed with a former Georgia coach, Vince Dooley. And Dooley's gone to the same restaurant, it's either for lunch or breakfast, every day for most of his retirement. And Dooley was the opposite. He said, you know what? Some days I wish somebody would actually recognize me. Because I've been retired for so long, they don't even know who I am anymore. Do you hear a tinge of I want to matter? Most of us aren't Olympians. Most of us aren't coaching top-tier college football teams. But we do this with other stuff. If I had that degree, I'll matter. If I had that role in our organization, I'll matter. If my paycheck had this many numbers, I'll matter. If my kids would just excel, I would matter. If my marriage would look like this, I would matter. We do it in the church. If my ministry is seen as a hallmark of who we are as a congregation, I matter. If people celebrate what I do, I matter. All you're doing is managing your guilt. You're trying to find something that can give you the value that God has already given you in Christ. The old covenant excelled in this type of sin management. If I do these things in God's eyes, I matter. That's what they had turned it into. And so God, in His grace, in His mercy, introduced this new covenant. That where the old one left guilt, where the old one left shame, where the old one left isolation and searching after meaning, where the crushing impact that hung over God's people never ended, the new covenant does away with that all. And it replaces it with a set of promises that are far more dear than anything the old covenant could promise. In quoting the prophet Jeremiah, what the writer of Hebrews wants us to see is this completion of what God was trying to do in His people. That yes, He found fault with His people because the obedience He required, they couldn't provide. They couldn't do what God commanded them to do. So now in the new covenant, you know what He does? He becomes the doer. And their doing becomes a divine gift from His hand. That we're able to hear the sweet words that we are His people, that He has taken us as His own, and we're able to follow after Him, not because of something in ourselves, but by the sheer power of His grace. And what you'll find if you look through the rest of verses 8 and 9 is this tale of how the people of old, the people of Israel, didn't continue in God's covenant. And so what's His response? I will establish a new covenant. He takes the role as active agent. He takes the role as the one who can accomplish what needs to be done in His people. The church father Augustine used to pray, Lord, command what you will and grant what you command. Don't just give us demands, but give us the power. And in the new covenant, God provides the power for His people to do and to be who He's called us to be. And he accomplishes that by doing a work from our inside out. And if you look at verses 10 and 11, he talks about putting his laws into the minds of his people, writing those laws on their hearts, owning them as their God. So much so that they wouldn't have to teach their neighbor or their brother to know the Lord, because everyone would know him. What the prophet pointed to and what the book of Hebrews is reinforcing is that God accomplished universal knowledge of himself through his people. You read through the Old Testament, and one of the most frustrating things is that the God's people, the people of Israel, are a mixed body. You have some who are Israel by birth only, but not by the new birth. What the prophet Jeremiah promised was an entire people who were saved, who were converted, who were regenerate, so that we no longer had to worry that our brothers and sisters in Christ struggled with knowledge of God, but everybody was on the same playing field, that the religious ranking that we try to use to assuage our guilt isn't possible, because we all have equal knowledge of God. That he would accomplish this not by something external, by rules and ceremonies, but by changing us from the inside out, by changing the hearts of his people. And one commentator described the old covenant like putting new clothes on a dead body. That I can go buy a $3,000 suit and put it on a dead man, but he's still dead. He can't do anything with that suit. What he needs is a new heart. He needs life. The old covenant gave us clothing to cover. The new gives us a new heart to live. And in giving us this new heart to live, God provides what his people needed. He gives us the right tools. And he sums it up in verse 12, "For I will be merciful toward their iniquities, and I will remember their sins no more." The Bible tells us time and time again, if you want to read a verse later, 1 Thessalonians 3, 11 through 13, that God is preparing us to present us blameless before himself. That if you're in Christ, if you're a Christian, God's in a process of beautifying you in holiness so that you're ready to meet him. And he does that by the work of his new covenant, by changing our hearts, by giving us knowledge of ourselves, by giving us the right tools. If you're hammering a nail, or if you're trying to drive a nail, and I hand you a screwdriver, some of you may be able to accomplish that feat. But for most of us, that's the wrong tool. You can't drive a nail with a screwdriver. You need a hammer. The old covenant didn't provide the tools God's people needed to be who he desires us to be. God has given us the tools, that he's removed our guilt. This mercy that the writer talks about is nothing new. God was merciful throughout the Old Testament. But what was new was the complete removal and the forgetting of sin. If you lived under the old covenant, you at least had to go once a year to deal with your sin and guilt. And the Day of Atonement, you were reminded that you may be forgiven, but you cannot enter God's presence. And if you use the sacrificial system to keep that regular throughout your year, daily, what you're reminded with each visit to the altar was your inability to deal with guilt once and for all. There's always going to be something more that you needed to do. And what's Hebrews' response to that? Christ died once for all, giving us complete confidence in the presence of God. That our sins are remembered no more. That guilt has been removed. Guilt is gone, and the work of Christ gives us the confidence to approach God with surety. I wonder the way that most of us struggle to apply this. You ever said this? I know God has forgiven me, but I just can't forgive myself. All that statement is a mixture of guilt management and pride. That statement is guilt management in we assume that it can't be this easy. We assume that forgiveness has to be harder. It requires more. That yes, God has forgiven me, but I surely have to do something else. Lewis, nothing is that simple. Which reveals our pride. That we think anything we could do to cover that guilt comes anywhere close to the work of God in Christ. What we're saying is, Jesus didn't do enough, but I can fill in the holes. That's the old covenant. I surely have to do something more. The new covenant tells us no. God in his mercy has forgiven it and forgotten it. The words of Paul ring true. Romans chapter 8. Paul tells the Roman church, really in focusing on a similar issue, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We usually stop there. We need to keep reading. Verse 2, for the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. If you're a Christian, if you've responded to the gospel, there is no statement of condemnation over you from the throne of God, because Jesus strengthened your weakness. He took on weakness himself to remove weakness forever. He bore our guilt himself, that we might be freed from guilt forever. That what we may see in our future is life and freedom and service and love and the glory of God in every aspect of our lives. And for us to go back, even in subtle ways, is to overlook the power of the gospel in our lives and in our world. Friends, you may have come here this morning to cover your guilt. It's going to be a miserable day, because God's removed it. And the more you try to cover it, the more he's going to show it to you. What we need to do is to rest in the fullness of these new covenant promises. So if you're here this morning, you're not a Christian, how good are you at dealing with your guilt? Jesus removed it forever. If you're here this morning, you're a Christian, why do you keep trying to cover your guilt? Why do you look down on a Savior who did a perfect work for you and provided perfect power in you, that now God can grant through his people what he commands, that by knowing him, we can grow to know him better. By being loved by him, we can seek to love him with the fullness of our being and love our neighbors in ways that seem insane to our society. That by being forgiven by Him, we can forgive with the great mercy shown to us. We can live in the freedom that He has offered us in Christ rather than the slavery of trying to cover our sin. I remember a pastor telling a story a few years ago. Failing this congregation had adopted a young boy. I forget if it was from overseas or here domestically. But over the course of him being in their home, they would find him pulling scraps of meals out of the trash can, hiding them. Because he was worried that there would be no food at the next meal. When it came time for bed, he would scream that they just wouldn't turn out the lights. Because he had experienced endless abuse. And darkness signaled to him pain. When he took off his shoes, he would hide them. Because he was afraid somebody else in the family would steal his shoes. And he'd be left with none. His new mom and dad had to sit him down one day and said, "You'll always have food. You'll always be safe. You'll always have what you need because we will do it. We will assure it. We will make sure fear leaves and joy and freedom come." Friends, is that not the gospel? In trying to ignore your guilt, you're hiding. In trying to manage your guilt, you're doing something that you know you can't do. But God in Christ has shown mercy. He's worked by grace. And He's spoken with confident assurance. "You know me. You're loved by me, and your sin is gone. So live. Live like you want. Live in the fullness of my gifts." Friends, are we living? Are we hiding from the mercy and grace of God? Let's pray together. Father, thank you is such an empty word because it doesn't sum up the fullness of our gratitude for what you've done. Father, from the best of us to the worst of us, we have the same need. And you took care of it in your Son. So, Father, I pray that we would indeed find and live in the freedom that you offer. Lord, our guilt would be gone. And when Satan pops up his head, trying to get us back to old guilt or provide us new guilt, we would simply point to a cross where our guilt is gone. Father, make this true of us. Do the work from inside out. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we take this opportunity to respond, I wonder what step of obedience God is calling you to take. Friend, have you spent your whole life trying to deal with your own guilt? Are you still separated from Christ? Consider for a moment the success rate that you've had in however many years you've lived. took Jesus one life and one day to remove it all. Respond to his grace. For those of us who that's already true of, an account from Martin Luther, the great reformer, comes to mind that some were asking Luther what he did when sin and guilt came to his mind. And pardon the language, but he said, "I merely tell Satan, go to hell. Because that's where he belongs, and that's where the sin and guilt is." So friend, with the encouragement of your pastor, today do you need to tell your sin and your guilt and Satan himself to go to hell? To free you to live in the fullness of a God who reigns on heaven's throne. Whatever step of obedience you have to take, step into the freedom that God offers us in Christ. Let's stand together and sing.